everybody. Let's go ahead and stand and worship God.
I need to know where to begin. After I let go, after I give in, and I want to see the hands that took the nails and bore all my sin. So take my burden, take my shame. Make this heart of mine beat again. Take my breath away and breathe. Breathe for me. I want to feel your fire burn, to know it's real and to come undone. And I want to hear heaven resound, and I want to taste the rain that falls on barren ground. So take my burdens, take my shame. Make this heart of mine beat again. Take my breath away and breathe. Breathe for me.
Doing this morning? Well, the left side of the house is awesome. Well, I guess it'd be your right side. Ooh. You guys awake? I know it's the early service. Sorry, my wife had to take care of my collar. So isn't it good to be here this morning? Yeah. A little better than last weekend weather-wise, right? Whew. So, we're doing things a little different this morning. We really felt like God had a lot to say. Not that he doesn't always have a lot to say, but I think there's just people here specifically that need to hear the message today. There's times in our lives when we hold on to things so tightly, we miss what God has for us. And what I mean by that, sometimes we just need to let go and let God take a hold of what we're struggling with. And we just need to be held. And that's what this next song talks about. It's just come to the throne room and fall at his feet and just be held. Amen.
So far away, not alone, stop holding on, just be
Find myself.
Can we do that chorus one more time? Sing with us.
I'm forever changed. Find myself lost in your grace. Never be the same again.
Sing that again.
I'm forever changed. Find myself lost in your grace. I'll never be the same again. Again.
I love that line of the song that says that you find yourself when you're lost in His grace. I just think that's an awesome place to be. Sometimes when we feel lost, then we can find ourselves when we're lost in Him. As we transition to this last song, my prayer, my heart's cry is that you would just realize what a good Father we serve, that He's all things good. No matter what's going on in your life, He's still good. He still sits on the throne. He still reigns. As we sing this last song, we have prayer leaders that are waiting at the wall to pray with you. So if you'd like to make your way that way, they're ready and waiting to celebrate with you, to pray with you, to cry with you, just to share your heart with them.
Shine all around. Then my eyes. Father, we just come right now in the mighty name of Jesus, and we thank you for the opportunity, God, just to gather together. God, just to be a blessing. Be a blessing to you, to bless you, to thank you, to praise you, to hopefully be a blessing to one another, and encourage one another, and God, just love on one another, Father. And so just thank you for bringing everyone here safely this morning. For all the plans that you have for each and every one, God, we just pray for open hearts this morning. We pray for open minds, God. We just pray for, God, just give you an invitation. God, that sounds even weird, God, that you would need one. But Father, you didn't come to force your will on mankind or humanity, God. You came extending an invitation and a reconciliation, God, and that relationship with you. And so, Father, we just want to make sure that we, right off the bat, just invite you in and give you room, give you place to work in each and every heart. And God, we just want to thank you for that. I wonder if we might, would you guys be willing to sing that second song one more time? There was a verse in that second song that said, things aren't falling apart, they're falling in line. And I just got stuck. And I think God's trying to tell us something this morning. Things aren't falling apart. You know, it may seem like it is, because how many know we have just a limited perspective. We can only see and hear and observe from our very tiny perspective what God is doing in the earth. Does that make sense? And I was just looking up. Sometimes if you ever see me, especially the worship team, because they can see me, if you ever see me on my phone during worship, I'm looking up a scripture, okay? I'm not on Facebook, and I'm not tweeting or emailing or anything like that. But I was looking up 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And Paul is writing to the church, and he said, now, don't get crazy about the second coming, and don't believe every rumor and all that. And then he begins to say, and some language, especially in the more traditional versions, say, before Jesus comes, there's going to be a great falling away. And some people interpret that differently, but the word falling is applicable in every situation. It may look like things are falling apart. Depending on your political persuasion, Friday, your perspective may look like, oh my God, the world is crumbling. Come on, let's be honest now. We have to honor one another, right? Maybe your political persuasion, you've thought that for the last 8 years. And that's why we live in the land of the free, in the home of the brave. So you can have that persuasion. You can have that feeling. You can have that mindset. But regardless if you think it was or think it is, I mean, in some ways you look around and you think, man, things really are. They're falling apart. But I just want to, what if we looked at it differently? What if instead of saying, man, I think my life is falling apart, or I think the world is falling apart, what if it's falling? You know, for God to rebuild, have you ever rebuilt something? Like my kids, having 4 kids, we've gone through a lot of Legos over the years, right? How many parents, if you've ever stepped on a Lego in the middle of the night and you've just about lost your religion? That is the hardest substance on planet Earth. Whatever they make them Legos out of, y'all know what I'm talking about? But what if we, kids, I would watch them build for a couple of hours. They'd build something, and then they'd put it in the box, and then they'd put it away. And the next time they'd bring it out, you know what they'd have to do before they built something new? They'd have to tear it all down to get the pieces that they need to make something new. And sometimes I honestly believe that we feel like God is tearing us down, or we feel like our world is falling apart. But I want to encourage you and remind you today that if you feel like that, it may very indeed be that God is not, you know, things aren't falling apart, that He's just taking this from and taking this to rebuild you. And maybe they're not falling apart, maybe they're falling into place. So as they sing this last song, this song again, I just want you to, I don't know, you just talk to God for a couple more minutes this morning and say, God, give me eyes to see things coming together, not falling apart, all right? And let's just trust Him that that's happening in our lives. Amen? All right.
Strong. Life hits you out of nowhere and barely leaves you holding on. When you're tired of fighting, chained by your control, there's freedom in surrender. Lay it down and let it go. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be healed. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be healed. Just be. If your eyes are on the storm, you wonder if I love you still. If your eyes are on the cross, you know I'll at least have and I always will. Not a tear is wasted, in time you'll understand. I'm painting beauty with the ashes, with your life is in my hand. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be healed. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be healed. Seems so far away. You're not alone. Stop holding on and just be healed. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne. Stop holding on and just be healed. Just be.
Come on, church, rejoice in that goodness of Him today. Amen. Thank you, team. Excellent. Wonderful job. I thought you were following me. Well, I know, but I came first. I'm sorry. Good morning. You can find your place as we transition this morning. It is so good to see everybody today. Welcome to Liberty Church International. God is good. God is still on the throne, whether or not it may seem or feel like it, because we can't go by those feelings. Amen. Amen. But welcome to everybody today. We are so encouraged that you are here today, and we would love to get to know you. And the way we can do that is if you'll just take a minute to find in the back of the chairs a communication card that looks like this. If you would like to know more about Liberty Family and get connected to this body, take a minute to find this card, fill it out, and in a moment we'll have a short offering break. You can drop this card in any of our kiosks, either here at the front of the sanctuary or at the back. But we are so glad that everybody is here, and then also all of our family and friends that's watching via the internet today. Let's welcome them, and good morning to you as well. Yes, I know there are several. Yeah. Yeah, we got the walkers that are up in Woodward because of work. So good morning to you guys too. Good, good. Hey, there's a lot of things that are going on. Check out your worship guide. There's lots of things that are listed. Some of these things have sign-up sheets. We have our XO Marriage Conference that's coming up in a couple of weeks. Don't miss out on that. If you would like to sign up, that information is out front as well. We've got our Liberty Discipleship classes that are gearing up to start in February. And how many in this room has been a part of these classes over the last year? Come on, if you've taken these classes, raise your hand with me. Yeah, have they been good? Amen, you recommend it? All right, so encourage those around you to go sign up for our next round of classes. This will benefit you in your growth and walk in Christ, so be a part of that.
Amen. Good stuff. Yeah, we're sharing, that's okay. Yeah, always be learning, always be growing. Right? Just like with the marriage conference, you can say, oh, my marriage is fine. Well, if that's all you want, is a fine marriage, then I guess that's cool. I think any marriage can be improved on. I think any relationship can be improved on. I think, you know, as we learn and grow in our relationship with God, more about others, that just serves to expand our perspective, our understanding, and just good stuff. So just as a Christian, man, as a human, always be learning and always be growing. Hey, one thing we want to just highlight today is the official observation, recognition of Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And our church is very involved in the local pregnancy care clinic here in Weatherford, just right up the road there. They're doing some amazing things. And I had the privilege of serving on the board for the Pregnancy Care Center during its creation before we ever had a building. And we've stayed very connected all these years since then. They've moved a time or two, and God has blessed them. They're right across the street from the college, just expanding their ministries all the time. And we are just excited to hear on a very regular basis all of the updates. You know, there's a lot of very abortion-minded ladies who go into the clinic and looking for options and looking for answers, and they're there to share the love of Jesus with them and the message of life. And it's a culture that we live in today that you know, has changed a little bit. And like we said, sometimes it looks like things are falling apart. But I want you to know that life is happening and good things are happening and God is blessing. And so we just want to celebrate, you know, all aspects of human life, you know, today and this month. And they're always looking for volunteers. If that's something that's near and dear to your heart, I know I was adopted. You know, and so I thank God that was an option back some years ago, you know, when that was happening. And so, you know, whatever your passion is today. Do you want to say something?
Speaking of adoption, Cassandra and Brandon, are you guys stand with your beautiful family? This family has been fostering for a number of years, and they have just made official. All these beautiful children are adopted now into their family. Yeah. So blessings to you guys. We love you guys. Six? Yeah. What a testimony of adoption, guys. And I know a few of those are siblings. And I don't know. Hear their story, guys. It's amazing. So we bless you and are so thankful for your willingness to step out. So, yeah.
Who am I like? Very first time.
Yes, Justin and Jolie, you guys have your grandson. I forgot his name. I apologize. Yeah. Precious, precious.
I heard he came to church last Sunday for the 9 a.m. service. And we weren't having a 9 a.m. service. You see, the challenge is there. The struggle is real, people. They drove all this way, and I was like, oh, man. You know, and I know we got lots of other families in the church that are fostering and just being a support, you know, for families in need or their family and those things. And so we just want to keep praying for them and keep supporting them and encouraging them. You know, God loves people who take responsibility. God loves that, and God blesses that. So continue to move forward and pray for this, and let's just celebrate Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And are we pretty much done?
We are done. And welcome, Julie, as she comes and take us into our offering moment. Welcome to you, hon.
Welcome. Good morning. Y'all ready for tithes and offerings? Hey, I've got an amazing book of the Bible, a chapter of the Bible that if you're wondering what God has you to read and you're kind of like dull in your Bible reading these days, get Philippians 4 and open it up, because there is some really cool verses in that that you can meditate on for weeks. But what we are here for today is tithes and offerings. Now, there's a story of Paul from the Bible. He was an amazing evangelist, and he traveled a long ways to spread the message of the gospel. And he always needed money. He needed offerings to help him along on his journeys. Yes? But many times when he was on his journeys, he would travel and set up churches and then move on and set up more churches and move on. And those churches would not support him in what he was doing. But there was one church that he mentions in Philippians, the church in Philippi, that was helping him out in his ministry. Now, if you look throughout the Bible, you'll see that Philippi was not a very rich church. As a matter of fact, they were hurting financially many of the times, but they would still support Paul on his missionary journey. And if we go to Philippians 4:14, yet it was kind of you, the people in Philippi, to share my trouble. And you Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving, except you people of Philippi only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. And then we go down to Philippians 4:19, a very famous verse. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Now, I've heard that verse spoken so many times. My God will supply everything for me. But you got to read it in context, because the people were supporting Paul and they were giving offerings to him, and therefore all their needs were being met. So I have an amazing prayer warrior in my life, Judy Henderson. And yesterday she was sharing a testimony for me about how God has provided for her, and I've invited her to come up and share this testimony with you. Everybody, welcome Judy.
So Pastor Scott was talking about stretching you. This is stretching me a lot. I pray in the back. I don't get up here. But talking about God supplying all your needs, this being January and after the holidays, kind of running low on money. So a couple of weeks ago, I had an opportunity to give, and I really didn't have it to give, but God's been dealing with me to just do it. Whatever I ask you, just do it. So I had the opportunity arose that I could bless someone, and it was the last $15 I had in my purse, and payday was a couple weeks away, and I was like, are you for real, God? And he said, yes, you know I got you. So I did. And so a couple weeks went by, and just last Wednesday, I just happened to be watching a message, and it happened to be on tithes and offering and giving in general. So there was this lady struggling to pay her bills, but God was also dealing with her to pay her tithes. And this one particular Sunday, she had said, okay, God, I'm going to pay my tithes. And her tithes was $100. And she was struggling to pay that. But as she was writing the check out, he said, not only are you going to pay your tithes, but you're going to give me $20 for offering. And she said, I can't. He said, just do it. I'll supply your needs. So she went ahead and wrote the check for $120. And as she walked out, of course, God sent someone to give that $20 back to her. But as I was listening to this, I was like, okay, God, I know you're a big God and you supply all of my needs. Not only can you give me the money back that you asked me to give, but you can give me $120. And so I was like, okay. And so the next day was Thursday, and somebody come up and said, God told me to give you this $20. So I was like, okay, cool. I got it back, and then I got $5 back. And then the next day, somebody come up to me and said, God laid on my heart to give you $100. So never underestimate God. And yes, he does supply all your needs. And whatever he's asking you to give, give. Because, yeah, be obedient.
Amen.
Cool, huh? That is Philippians 4 in action. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for these blessed people in this place. God, I thank you that their ears are open to hear your voice. God, we ask now that you tell each one of us what we are to give to you, Father, to provide for this church, but also for others. Help our ears to be open. Help our heart to be open to receive. Father, I thank you for the people online. I feel a special need to bless those people watching, Father. I bless them financially, God. Open the storehouses of heaven and pour out to those who are watching right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. Tell them, God, that he hears you and he knows you. He knows you intimately and he knows every need of yours in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for blessing everybody here. Thank you for keeping us safe and protected through this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Come on back in. Find you a seat. We're not done yet. We're just getting warmed up, right? Just getting started. Man, you guys got quiet. How reverent. Anybody ever grow up in one of those churches where it was always quiet? You couldn't say nothing or you just walked in like... That wasn't my church, by the way. Yeah. I grew up in one of those crazy Pentecostal churches where people were running and dancing and shouting. And it's called full gospel, right? We learned about that a little bit. Oh, I'm so glad you're here. God's done so many amazing things already. I love the diversity of how God, you know, the diversity of the church is kind of reflects God's diversity. And, you know, just his personality, it's just amazing. And so we're thankful and blessed to have such a rich diversity. We're also, you know, we talked a little bit, I did this morning, about perspective. And it's good as we learn to get the different perspectives on ministry. And one of the best ways to do that is to give a different generational perspective. How many know we've been talking about generations for a while, right? We've been talking about legacy. There can be no legacy without the multi-generational insight and input and succession and all those things. And we have been blessed in this church to just have an overabundance of gifted leaders and teachers and preachers. And we just thought it was appropriate this morning to share that. We want to do that about at least once a month, if not more, to give some of these young and up-and-coming ministers an opportunity to share and sow into your life. So this morning, Cameron is prepared a message, a word from God, and he's going to come and bless you today. So you guys give him a big round of applause as he comes, all right?
Thanks.
Get him.
Thanks.
Love you.
Love you too. All right. Are we on? Can you hear me? We good to go? Cool deal. No? Nicole? Quiet. Good deal. Let me get this going here. 2017, new year. You know, everyone excited. Everyone kind of start off the new year saying, New Year resolution, 2017 is my year. It's finally the year that I was going to do the things that I said I was going to do in 2016, that I talked about doing in 2015, that I planned in 2014. You know, we got any of those type of people out here today? But no, 2017, New Year's, you know, so many people start off with New Year's resolutions. I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to gain weight. I'm going to start reading more. I'm going to start going with my family more. I'm going to start doing all these things. And there's a study done by Forbes magazine that says only 8% of the people today in 2016 finished their New Year's resolution. Only 8%. So when you think of that, you know, we're already in the third and a half week of January. So, I mean, you don't got to raise your hands or anything, but I mean, who started New Year's resolution and already have given up? You know, just think about that. They're 8% finished. So as we go throughout this new year, as we go continue on 2017, I want to challenge you and encourage you that even if you had given up already, to continue on. And that if you are still going strong, I want to encourage you and be your accountability partner of saying, keep with it. You know, let's keep going. Amen. Amen. This is a new year, but we serve the same God. Yeah. Hebrews 13 and 8 says, for he is the God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He is the Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There's no separation. Even though that we may be in a new year, we still serve the same God. The promises that he declared over your life in 2017 or 2016 and 1996, whatever it may be, they're still true today. God doesn't turn away. God does not return void in the words that he speaks over each and every one of your lives today. We got anybody, I know Steve and Amy right there. I know y'all have kind of done some marathons and stuff like that. Anybody else, anyone else run some marathons? I know Jen, you've run marathon before. Anybody else? This Christian lifestyle that we go through, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. You know, growing up in high school, I had the opportunity to run track 1 year. I know Shane, you've ran track several times, and we've talked about this. You know, I was a sprinter. I was none of this long-distance stuff. I kind of just got thrown into the track world. I was a sprinter. I didn't like the long distances. I tried it one time. Coach was like, you know what? Why don't you just try the open 800? Why don't you just try that? Shane's shaking his head. He knows, too. It's an awful race. Two laps around as fast as possible without giving up. It wasn't for me. I tired out too quickly. But this Christian life that we were walking, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. Hebrews 12, verse 1 talks, therefore, since we are surrounded by a large crowd of witnesses. Surrounded by a large crowd of witnesses. That sounds like a marathon, right? Everyone gathers around. There's people lining the streets to see you run. Large crowd of witnesses, let us strip off everything that slows us down, especially sin, and let us run the race with endurance that God has set before us. We must strip off everything, including sin. You know, another thing that we need to strip off is the forgiveness into people's lives. We forgive not for them, but for us. We battle forgiveness so many times that we have the hatred that is in our heart, the stubbornness to not forgive people who've done us wrong, and that sin is weighing us down. It's like having to run a marathon with a rucksack on your back. That's not fun. That's not fun. Caleb, how much do those rucksacks weigh? 45 pounds. Can you imagine trying to run? Steve, imagine an extra 45 pounds when you're running. Do you want to do that? Absolutely not. So that forgiveness allows you to be set free. That sin that's holding you back has caused stress in your life, has caused your mind to run and wander away from the race that is set before us. Paul writes in 2 Timothy 4:7, he says, for I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. And because of that, there is a crown of righteousness laid up for me. He says, I have kept the faith. What does he mean by keeping the faith? He says that I have stayed disciplined to the Lord's teachings. I have stayed disciplined to following after Jesus Christ. I have stayed disciplined to praying every single day, the world today has done a good job of changing what the word discipline means. When you think of the word discipline, what do you think, kids? What do you think? It means correction. It means, yeah, so he was going like that. It's this dude, smack you around a few times. It's the world has gotten this off point of what discipline really is. It's not none of this harsh punishment or anything like that. But I want to tell you, discipline states to train oneself to do something in a controlled and habitual way. To train oneself to do something in a controlled and habitual way. So we can look at the word discipline and go back and say, no longer is it about harsh punishment. No longer is it about the bad things of God. But instead, Paul writes, I have stayed disciplined to the Lord's teachings throughout my marathon, throughout my race of life. When I have gone from church to church, planting these places, I have stayed disciplined to everything that God has taught me in my walk with Him. Discipline is necessary as sons and daughters. Hebrews 12:5, it states that the Father's discipline is necessary in the Lord's discipline. The fathers, our natural fathers, give discipline to us, but how much more does our Lord give discipline to us? His training techniques, everything that He has laid out for us, that way we may run this marathon, that way we can run this race that we call Christianity. So I just want to put an acronym together for y'all of the word discipline that it may allow you to run this race, run this marathon without tiring out. Amen? So we'll just start off with D. And this first one, D, die to Christ every day. We must first die to Christ every day. If we want to stay disciplined, we must first die to Christ every day. Matthew 16:24 says, for any of you who want to follow me, take up your cross. You must first take up your cross if you want to follow me. The cross, the crucifixion, the symbolize of death. As we enter into a relationship with God, when we say yes to Him as sons and daughters, we die to man. We die to the things of the world, and we say yes to Him. He was talking to His disciples in this. And that's all that disciples is. It's just a different name for disciplined learners. Jesus had with Him 12 disciplined learners who stayed with Him, who stayed obedient, who didn't get tired and quit after mile one. They had to walk everywhere back then. They didn't just get to get in their cars and drive. They didn't get to fly from one city to the next. They had to walk. Can you imagine that first night after a long night of preaching to people, if they had to walk to a town 4 or 5 miles away, and Paul or one of the other disciples said, you know what, I give up. But no, he stayed disciplined. He stayed disciplined. Next thing you know, you have to have an intimate relationship with Christ instead of a religious relationship with Christ. Intimate relationship with Christ versus a religious relationship with Christ. Religious relationship says, I got to keep the Ten Commandments. Religious says, in order to love God, I can't steal, I can't kill, I can't commit adultery, I can't take the Lord's name in vain. Intimate relationship says, just love the Lord your God. What did Jesus say was the two greatest commandments in the world? Number one, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But we get caught up on the Old Testament ways. We try to please God. We think that if we do this and if we don't do this, then we will have that relationship with God. But that's not the case. We're just taught to love God. We're taught that, see, when we love God, when we're in this intimate relationship with Him, we are in this perfect comfort zone. This area right here, that is our comfort zone. We're able to just stay with Him, hold Him. He holds us. We just begin to share with how much we love You, God. We thank You for the life You've given us. We stay in this comfort zone because it's a safe place. It's an intimate place with Him. And as we stay in this comfort zone, we begin to build a relationship with Him. We get to officially know Christ. We get to know Christ. In the Bible, there's definitions of knowing one another. It said that when Adam and Eve knew each other, they bore a child. So do you know Christ this morning? Do you really know Him on an intimate relationship? Not a religious relationship of just coming maybe once or twice a month on Sunday mornings. But I'm talking about each and every day when you wake up, you have that intimate relationship saying, thank You, Father. Thank You, God. Same thing with your spouses. You want to have that intimate relationship. You don't just talk maybe once or twice a week. That doesn't build strong marriages. Does that work for y'all if y'all just talk once or twice a week? It doesn't. It causes friction. It causes fights more than likely. You have to have an intimate relationship, that constant communication with Christ. And as we move into finally having that intimate relationship, we get to where we want to have an S, a scripture-based lifestyle. No longer is reading the Bible difficult for us because we started having this personal relationship, this intimate relationship with Christ that says, okay, now we're going to begin reading what You have written for us. So many times people say, I need a word of God, or I haven't heard God speak to me in a while. Well, go back to the Bible and see what He said for you. We get caught up in, I need a word, I need a word. He's written you several words. Begin getting in that prayer closet. Get in that war room and seek the word, seek the promises that He gave for you. Did you know that He wishes above all things that you prosper and be in health? He doesn't want you sick. He doesn't want you poor. That's not what He has for the church as a whole. He wants each and every one of you to prosper and be in health. Amen. He knows the plans that He has set for you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Stand on those words this morning. Start small as we begin reading. Don't get caught up. As you go through a marathon, you don't try to run 26 miles on day one. It doesn't work. You get worn out. You get depressed. And then halfway through, probably mile three, you quit. If you even get to mile three, you'll probably just quit. So start small. Get one scripture. And then you can build on that. As soon as you start hearing God's word, finally, you can begin to have a community living lifestyle as well. The church that we are in is community. Life groups that you go through throughout the week are community. When one people need each other, we have community. We were joking with this. Some people were needing moves a couple weeks ago or whatever, and they said, are they in a life group? Well, then their life group can take care of it, right? Because that's what happens when you're in a life group. If you are in a community, if you are in a life group, you're doing life together. That life helps you out. You don't stay all by yourself. You know, that's why they call it solitary confinement. It's a punishment. It's in prison. We're not meant to live that way. We're meant to live in community. We build one each other up. You know, here in Weatherford, what is the last statistic? Like 20-something churches here in Weatherford? 20-something churches here in Weatherford. Why? Because it goes back to that religious aspect. I don't agree with you, so I got to go start my own church. Oh, I don't like the way you do worship here, so I got to go do worship over here. But imagine if communities, if the churches could come together as one community. Like we've talked about back in the day, they had one church. The church of Ephesus, the church of Corinth, there was only one church. That's how things were getting done. The courthouse was the church. The meeting house, the town hall meetings were at the church. The church was one body. The church comes together for one corporate goal. But so many times, life has done a great job of getting us off track. Maybe saying, I don't want to come this Sunday morning. And you don't come one Sunday, and then you say, well, that's kind of nice. You know, I was able to do a few things. Then you take another Sunday off. Then another Sunday. But that's how being in a life group, that's how having accountability partners in the church is good. If you miss one or two Sundays, someone's texting you. Where are you at? Are you on vacation? If so, that's okay. Have fun. But if you're just sitting at home, not doing anything, you need to be here. Because once or twice on a Sunday is not good enough. If you just work out once a month, if you just run preparing for a marathon once or twice a month, that's not it. And that's when we get into I. There's a lot of I's in discipline. There's like four or five I's. I don't even remember. There's so many. But no, I. We got to start increasing our workout. Start increasing your workout. As a runner, you don't just run 1 mile every day, do you, Steve, to train for the marathon? When you lift weights, you don't just lift the bar every single time. You don't just bench press with 45 pounds on each side. You continue to increase. After you started small, after you finally have gotten one scripture down, you start building on that. You start maybe saying, God, I like these scriptures. I like seeing the things that you've been doing in my life. I'm trusting in you. Now I'm starting to read the whole book of the Bible. Where I was starting with just scriptures, I'm reading complete books of the Bibles now. Where I was just going once or twice a month on Sunday mornings, I'm going all four Sundays. Where I may be just going to life group once a month, I'm going all four times. Maybe there's a nursing home deal. I'm going to that. We must increase. Yeah, Judy likes that one, doesn't she? We must increase our workouts. We can't stay the same. If we want to fight the good fight of faith, if we want to stay disciplined, that way we can run this race with endurance, we got to continue to increase, continue to get stronger, continue to read, continue to pray, continue to worship. And as you begin to do all these things, we can then do P. We can pass your knowledge on to others. We've talked about this, generations. We've talked about finding mentors, finding mentees. Steve, I'm sure you have great tips of what not to do and what to do during a marathon. You know, don't train this way. Train this way. Same thing in the kingdom of God today. When we get mentors, we need these mentors. We need these mentees of passing it on to one another. This is how you pray. Are you willing to be disciplined learners of Christ? Find that mentor in your life today. Allow God to perform miracles in their life. When you begin to find that mentee, find that mentor, depending on who you are, the goodness of God begins to flow. That discipline in your life, that race begins to be fun. It doesn't suck. You know, after those first few workouts, after the first few races, your legs are jello, your arms are jello, working out, whatever it may be, you feel that pain, you think, ah, this sucks. But then you get people who's been there, who's done this, and you know what? They say, it's fun. It's a lot of fun. You got to do this. Keep going. You're okay. You're not going to die. You're not going to die. You're going to make it. That's one thing I loved about playing sports in high school. They knew how to push your limits. Whenever you thought that you were going to fail, whenever you thought you couldn't run another 40 on the football field, the coaches say, get to the line, we're doing five more. And you're thinking, you're standing there with pads on, and it's 100 degrees at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and you're saying, there's no way I can run another 40. But coaches say, you know what? You can run 40, or you can run five more 40s. That's the same thing we need. In this world today of Christian lifestyle, we need mentors. We need the mentees saying, you know what? You can do this. Don't stop now. Don't stop coming to church now. You're almost there. Do you see the things that God's written for you? You're almost there. Don't give up now. Please come to church this Sunday. I'll be praying for you. I'll come pick you up. I'll do whatever needs to happen. But you're almost there. Don't give up now. Don't give up now. And as we move on, we can do L. We can what's called learn to laugh through the pain. Learn to laugh through the pain. Sometimes, like we've said, that those workouts aren't always fun. Getting up early sometimes isn't always fun. Maybe you can get almost to the finish line. You're at mile 20, 25, whatever it may be. Your legs are feeling like jello. I don't know. I haven't run a marathon, so I can't say anything like that. But I've run. I've been in football. I've done these things where you've gotten down, you said, you just start laughing. You know, same thing with our Christian lifestyle today. The joy of the Lord is our strength. You've been going good. You've been running. You're at that cruise pace, you know. You're set about 75, 80%. You're just cruising along. And then, bam, you get blindsided by the devil. You wonder, what the heck just happened? I was doing so well. I was doing so great. What just happened? The devil is making sure to see if you are going to stay disciplined to this race or not. Staying disciplined to your walk with Christ. He will blindside you, and you have one or two options. One, you can stay down and say, I'm defeated. Devil, you beat me. I'm all right. I'm just going to continue how I'm living. Or you can do two. You can get up, brush yourself off, and just start laughing at the devil. You can be like, ha-ha, you know what? You may have gotten me. You may have knocked me down this time, but guess what? I've got a God of more than enough. I might get knocked down 7 times, but I'm going to get up 8. You, nothing can come against me. Anytime you get in my life, anytime you try to hurt me, I've got a God that I serve. I know someone that I have an intimate relationship with. Amen. And he is God of all. So you can do whatever you want, devil. Pretty soon, he ain't going to touch you. He ain't going to mess with you. He's tried. He might get into your life, but as you continue to laugh through the pain, laugh through the hard times and say, I know God's got me. This may be my last $15, but I know that God's got me. I know God's going to bless me $120 because he said it. I've read scripture. I've read where he's blessed others. I've read where he's done these things. So I know that if he's done it for my brother, he's done it for my sister, he can also do it for me. And that's where we get into inspire or influence others. Inspire or influence others. Revelations 12:11 says, for we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And we've already died to Christ. Amen. That blood of the Lamb, we're already here, and now we're getting to here. We're getting to sharing our testimony. We've gotten to Judy standing up here doing these things, getting out of her comfort zone. We finally, when we're in that intimate relationship with Christ, we can be in our comfort zone. It's okay. But as we begin to get out and start actually running the marathon, as we begin to share the word of God with people, we must step out of our comfort zones. We must get out here into where the waters may be rising. These are where the people are that's hurting. These are where the people are that needs us. We must first step out here. After we've been in our intimate relationship, after we've been in that comfort zone, we must get up in here to deep waters. And God will take care of us, because we said we've already had that intimate relationship with him. But we must inspire others. You know, one thing that we have decided to do, we've heard, you know, great testimonies and cool stories of people running marathons and different things like that. Well, we decided as a Page family that we aren't going to run the marathon, but during the OKC Memorial, we're going to do the 5K. You know, we've heard great stories. People have influenced us. You know, we're not at the marathon level yet, but we're at the 5K, and we're getting there. That's a start. It's a start, Steve. We're almost there. So you think, it's, you know, 26.2 miles is a long ways. That's a long ways. I don't think I've ran that much in a long time. It's a long ways. But we started somewhere. We've had people inspire us, influence us to do these things. So we say as you go throughout your day, as you're in your workforce, tell those testimonies of everything that God has done for you. Tell those things that God has done for you, even though that the devil has done things that you have in, that you have never given up. Fatigue happens. Fatigue sets in. Your muscles begin to tighten. You don't want to move as much. But God says, never give up. Paul said, I have fought the good fight. I have kept the faith. I have stayed disciplined. He never gave up. He never wants y'all giving up. And that's one thing we must do. As we never give up, we get to tell those stories of this is how I got here because I never gave up. I never give up. I never quit. You know, when devil came against me, when adversity came against me, what did you do? I rose above it. Why? Because I serve a God that is more than enough, that can take care of all my needs. And as you begin to do this, you can start to exalt the Lord your God. What did Paul say again in 2 Timothy? He says, I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished the race. Afterwards, you are rewarded the cross, the finish line. Stay in humble and exalt God for giving you all the glory and praise. You know, as you begin this 2017 year, as you begin to run marathons, after you maybe complete your marathons, there's things called Ironmans. Anybody heard of Ironmans, what these kind of races are? We've heard a few of them. You know, these are hardcore. You think marathons are bad enough? There's things called Ironmans, like Ironman. Like, you must swim 2 miles, 2.2 miles, then you bike over 100 miles, 112, and then you must run a marathon. So you're not just running a marathon, you're doing all of these things. So as you begin on this walk with Christ, maybe you said, okay, I have done these things. I have kept the faith. I have stayed disciplined in this marathon. Now it's time to get challenged to move on to different things, better things. You know, a marathon isn't challenging enough. I want to do something else. Can you imagine if we got that way with God? You know, Sunday morning isn't enough. 4 times a month on Sunday, 4 times a month of life group isn't enough. I need something else. I need a challenge. Maybe going to Haiti once a year isn't enough. Where's that grit? Where's that passion that we have, that fire burning inside of us? It's kind of gone away. But I'm telling you things, if you go through this process, if you stay disciplined to the Lord's trainings, I guarantee you that passion, that zeal will be burning inside of each and every one of you to run these Ironmans. You know, I call those people crazy. But what if we were radicalized and crazy Christians? You know, who cares what the world thinks of us? Who cares what we look like? Who cares that we're sweating and going crazy because we've just done something that no man should do? Why would anybody put their body through so much torture in this Iron Man? People may look at you and say, why are you doing these things? You say, baby, let me tell you my story. Let me tell you the things that God has done for me. Because as passionate as I am, you can also be this passionate. Amen. I challenge each and every one of you, stand up to your feet. Stay disciplined in the ways of the Lord. Increase those workouts. Don't just stay at 1 mile your whole life. You know, we say, but I'm content there. God loves you too much to keep you there. 1 mile is not good enough. Get to that 26.2 miles. And afterwards, you know, it might take a week or it might take a month, but say, I'm ready for a new challenge. I'm ready. God, challenge me to do the impossible. Let's move in supernatural ways. You know, if we want to see the signs, wonders, and miracles take place, we must get to this 26.2 miles. We must go through this discipline process. We want all these things to happen, yet we're still running at mile one. This can't happen. It's a process. We get through this discipline process. We run the 26.2 miles. We get to this Ironman race, and we said, you know what? It's time. The dead will rise. The blind will see. The mute will speak. It's time that these things come to pass. That's why I love Liberty Church. We're doing things differently, but it's time that this different becomes the norm. That's how it was in the Bible days. We call it, those things are different. That's weird. But no, God's saying, you know what? That's how it's done. That's how we did it. That's the way it's supposed to be done. Amen. Just sitting, being content with 1 mile is what's different. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that each and every one of these people, that set a fire into their lives, God, that they'll become disciplined learners of you. Because we know that as we begin to go through this process of building an intimate relationship with you, as we read the promises you put on our lives, God, that we'll go back into the world and preach the gospel on fire with you, running the race, keeping the faith, God. And as we know, we won't go weary. We won't go faint, because you'll be right there by our side each and every step of the way. So, God, we thank you. We give you all the praise and glory. In your name we pray. Amen. Man, are you blessed? Are you encouraged? Are y'all ready to run those 26.2 miles today? I hope you are. I hope you are. 2017, this is our year. We've said it many times, but I believe those pieces are finally coming together. What we thought was falling apart, they're coming together. Those races were set forth. The fight that God has given us. Amen, amen. Be blessed. Shake a hand, hug a neck, and tell them God loves them. You're dismissed. Thank you.